Now, everything that I've said, of course, is in the context of the overall fact that nature is really our attempt to change what we are. It's a futile, delusional, illusory attempt, like a dream, to change what we are. It's like a dreamer dreaming a dream of changing what they are. So everything I say is arises within this the big context that nature is this delusionary belief that we can change what we are. It's an attempt to change what we are, and we're imagining determinism, meaning process, form, time, space. None of this is true at all. There's no such, nothing's ever happened actually. There's never been any nature at all. But we have this dream of nature. So everything I'm saying is talking about this dream of nature, which is an attempt to change what we are. Of course, what nature does is it keeps producing the future, so to speak. Form, keeps producing bodies, forms, right? And this is what we call the feminine component, produces the body. So it's central to this dream of nature. You know, sure, men, you know, help take care of bodies, etc., and have some part role, but essentially, nature is feminine. That's what produces the body. So the status of the feminine is, you know, way higher than the status of the masculine in this dream of nature. Way higher, intrinsically so, has to be. And there's no way to even it out whatsoever. No possibility of ever evening it out, even though. It's like a credit card company said, he said, oh, here, we'll send you a credit card, zero interest for a couple of years, you know. And then later on, oh, okay, now we're going to charge you 20% once you really do a lot of purchasing, you know. So there have been times when men think that they have some sort of, you know, high status or equal status to women in the world, but they never do. They don't. It's things always turn around and say, uh-oh, you know, no, it's just like a... You borrowed from a bank or something. You got to repay. So, nature is inherently unfair in terms of status. Men are inherently lower class, lower status in this dream of nature. Inherently so. There's no way to change that whatsoever. It's impossible. So, is, you know, who wants to have a perpetual lower status? I sure don't. So I have no stake, no stock, no interest in nature, future of nature at all. I want to get free of that. I don't want to live in a state of perpetual lower status. What is that? I want to have, you know, equal status, which is reality is perfect equal status to all. Okay, to all. There's not even a theme of status in reality whatsoever. Only in this dream of nature. Which is producing form. This dream of attempting to make ourselves different than what we really are, which is we're formless, we're indeterminate, we're perfectly free. So I just bring up this dynamic, and of course more men throughout history have sought liberation because they don't want to be second-class citizens in nature, inherently so, even though again, it's dressed up to appear that men have some status, you know, but they, not when it boils right down to it, they're very, very expendable. Very expendable. And this is intuitively, if you we're not following the script of the world, like you're what you're supposed, how you're supposed to act and what you're supposed to say, if you just look at it objectively, it's just obvious. It's obvious. And these days, of course, all pretension that it's otherwise is kind of being dropped at this point, you know. And you men are feeling like, wow, we're just total second-class citizens, inherently so, with no possibility of ever changing that. So, of course, you know, we're going to say, hey, let's see if we can't be liberated from this nature. Now, supernature, again, there's no process, there's no bodies being produced, there's no inherent higher status for the feminine in supernature at all. Okay, so there's equal status there too. Now, of course, you know, it's interesting about this equal status thing, because it's difficult for everyone, because if you've been a lower status in nature, in this dream of nature, having equal status is like weird, like, whoa, you know, do I deserve this? It's very... But on the other hand, if you had this higher status, like the feminine, having equal status is weird too. They say, wow, this is really weird. So it's weird for both male and female. Yeah, those roles, those attention patterns, different for difficult for both. Difficult, very difficult for both. To this whole truly equal status thing is very difficult in supernature. And of course, this idea of quote unquote equal status in the world is a complete sham. It's a complete sham again. It's like a marketing of a credit card company trying to get you to use their card, and then later, big trouble, big interest rates start coming in. So don't fall for this nonsense in the world that somehow you can attain some sort of equal status. No, nature has a purpose. Nature has a purpose. It's to continue to present this parade of bodies. Okay. Yeah, so that's what it's all about. That's its function. That's its purpose. And so it will definitely say this is what is central to this. This is what is central to it. This is what's most important. It lays down the law, as far as that goes. That is for sure. Again, all this set in the big picture context. Now, it is possible to see through the whole situation and have this sort of total viewpoint that just liberates. But it's so clear in all directions. You cannot discursively, linearly explain it, because it's all simultaneous. It all is one clarity. So, as Jesus says over and over, you cannot explain the truth. You cannot explain it so others can understand. It's not possible. You have to experience it. What's that? Someone there. What we do in the fourth phase is we go beyond explanation. Go beyond explanation. Always we're pushing to go beyond explanation. A leap of faith. I don't know where, I don't know when, I don't know what. I don't know what, where, and when I am at all. I don't know where I am, I don't know what I am, I don't know when I am. It's all beyond explanation. It is all beyond explanation. Truth is beyond any explanation. You cannot put truth into the context of the dream of nature. It's not possible. You cannot put it in that context. So we're always trying to shock the mind, stun the mind, stagger the mind with the good news of no explanation. Going in that way, no explanation. So you cannot go back into words, try to put it in words. It's a journey beyond words. As soon as you try to put it into words, you will feel the second-class feeling, especially if you're a man. You'll feel like, I need to explain it and justify it to the central, bureaucracy of nature. And you can't do that. You can't do it. So you have to step outside, so to speak, of nature. You have to realize the total, I am not anywhere, I am not anything, I am nothing, and I am nowhere. I am nothing, and I am nowhere. I'm not anything, and I'm not any place at all. Even including everywhere, even including everything. I'm neither anything or anything. I'm neither anywhere or everywhere. Even beyond being everywhere or everything. It's more like we're like pure potential for everywhere and anywhere and everything and anything. It's more like that. So reality, it has nothing to do with producing bodies, biology, chemistry, anything like that. It's a manifestation. And God The ground of being reality is pure potential, infinite potential, with no residue ever being produced whatsoever by either any manifestation or non-manifestation, or repeat manifestation or repeat non-manifestation. It's immaculate. So there's this perfect equality. Everyone is, all is perfectly free to experience any potential they want to, or to not experience any potential they want to. Over and over and over and over endlessly if they want, without producing any sort of change or residue whatsoever in reality. So there's absolutely no gender in reality whatsoever. No bodies, no gender, not even an issue of equality. It's just pure freedom, pure freedom. A far cry from nature. Now, I attained some status in a previous life, and maybe in several, but actually, looking back, it was only at the discretion of the women, of the world, actually, because I did something that they smiled upon. I was too stupid enough to think that, well, maybe I had actually had some real status. I did not have any real status. It was like the credit card company say, you know what, you're a gold card member, so we're going to keep your interest rates low. So I thought, wow, I'm really important, you know. And then this life, they said, no, you know, we're going to jack the interest rates sky high and destroy you. So I was, you know, foolish enough to make that big mistake. There's no way you can go against nature in the dream of nature. Okay, you cannot. You have to drop the dream of nature. You have to set it down. You have to exchange it for supernature. You have to exchange the belief system of determinism for the belief system of indeterminism. From the belief system of imprisonment for the belief system of freedom. So, you know, really having so much experience from the male side, it's like, I don't know what, like I have a, you know, continuity problem for with this feeling of equality. I wouldn't know what that's like, you know. It's like being a prisoner for so long, so low status, second class slave status for so long. I don't, emancipation, I don't know, can I even handle that feeling, you know what it's like. And then conversely, for the women to have this feeling like they don't have any slaves. No more slaves, or no slaves, no possibility of slaves, no possibility of second classness, no status like that at all. Yeah, that's a severe continuity issue too, very severe. And even beyond that is this absolute perfection of reality. So we all have a severe continuity problem, actually, the same problem, continuity problem. And truly, I feel like the feeling of being emancipated from being a slave it scares me to death, you know, it's almost to death. And you want to like run back and say, oh, I'm sorry, God is there, you know, God is there, let me, what can I do to make you even greater, higher status, you know, so I can gain a little bit of, and you think if you serve the goddess and do make them even look even more higher and wonderful, and give them all these comforts and stuff they want, that they'll, you know, elevate you up. Well, kind of, they pat you on the head and say, good job, you know, good job. Then they're done with you, they run along, go back to your slave headquarters. You never, ever reach the, men never reach the status of women in this world, never. It's not possible. So you might be their favorite plaything for a while, but when you're no longer their favorite plaything, goodbye. They throw you in the gutter and not even give you the time of day as they walk past. That is a fact that I have experienced. But the bigger context is, we all have this severe problem of freedom, don't we? Severe continuity problem towards freedom. One says, oh my gosh, I'm going to gain status. Other says, oh my gosh, I'm going to lose status. But really, we're going to feel like free of all status. So we're so used to nature and its ways to be free of nature. You know, we're like, what does that feel like? Why, gosh, I don't know where I am. I don't know what I am. I don't know. I don't know, I don't know. But this I do not know is wonderful. No status, right? I don't know what my status is. Because I don't have any. I don't need any. I have perfection, and perfection is not status. Status implies a higher and a lower. So to say, I do not know, I do not know, I do not know. No explanation. Explanation implies you need to explain someone to something, which implies status, or someone's demanding an explanation. Reality doesn't demand any explanation from its for what it is at all. There's no demand for any explanation. There's no demand for anything for reality. Reality doesn't demand anything be given to it, anything sacrificed to it, anything explained to it. It has no needs whatsoever, no needs, no demands. No needs, no demands. So we need to just experience that. And both from the perspective of the male attention pattern, female attention pattern, just say no deals, no deals at all. Just blanket, no deals. I'm not making any deal with nature at all. See? And that's a blanket statement. Whatever kind of deals, you know, you'd say all deals are off, no deals anymore. Absolutely no deals. This is sort of a technique can be used. No deals. Leap of faith, no deals. I don't know what I am. I don't know where I am. I do not know anything. I do not know anything at all. I don't know anything. Don't know anything. So I don't know any. I'm just saying there's no such thing as determinism. I don't know anything. No deals, no deals, no deals, no deals, no deals, no deals. So I'm looking at this as a way to prevent, once we have this vision of oneness, how to just abide in this vision of oneness, and you just have to say no deals. And understand the continuity fear that people have. Is in this world with the male, both male and female have severe fear of coming out of their comfort zone, a status comfort zone. So they'll want to make some deal. They say, well, I got to make some deal here. No deals, just have to spiritual practice, move your comfort zone. That's not a deal, that's an ordeal. Okay, not a deal, but an ordeal is what's necessary. Everyone here wants to make a deal, but what we have to do is go through the ordeal. And so there's loss of status is always, in this world, it's always talked about. Everyone's terrified of it. The women say, if I lose status, I'll fall down so low and men will just lord it over me, lord it over us. And the men say, oh my gosh, if I gain higher status, I might just go crazy and overindulge and, you know, just be like a tyrant or something. So we're all terrified of dropping, you know, this whole status game of nature, this whole scheme of nature. So there's a continuity fear over that, for sure. But again, no deals. No deals whatsoever. Just saying, no deals are being made anywhere. So we're just staying in the status-free condition. So you don't fall into some craziness. Status-freeness is this just a steady, clear light bliss. Clear light bliss. Now, to shift gears a little bit here, to keep the intensity going here. And again, full stop in the intensity, in the wow, and the burn of this. Whatever it's triggering, bringing up, just full stop in that. And then full stop in the determinism of it. In the mind being staggered. Just allow that. Don't struggle with it. Just allow it. Had quite an experience last night. I found out that... the San Francisco Giants legendary pitcher Madison Bumgarner was going to appear on this late night TV show called Late Night, whatever, Jimmy Fallon, the Tonight Show or something. This guy named Jimmy Fallon. Well, okay, so I said, I gotta watch this, see what he has to say. So I tuned in to 11:35 at this Tonight Show, and this guy comes on. And I was like, whoa, this is really weird. I said, wow, this guy's really weird. I don't like him at all. I don't like this. There's something really out of whack and strange here that just really feels like it's busting up my spiritual momentum. You know, by the way, soul is another term for spiritual momentum. So Jesus said, be afraid of those who can kill the soul. Well, it means bust your spiritual momentum up. Okay, so I said, this guy's really a momentum buster, you know. Good Lord. And then, so I said, I can't watch this guy. I was getting revulsion. And I got sick to my stomach. I said, I cannot watch this guy. Absolutely revolting. And then the skits that they had that came on, this old lady, and it's just horrible stuff. I said, good Lord. How can anybody watch this without the feeling of extreme revulsion? And then I began to look at the people and the audience and everything there. I realized bodies are horrible. I said, bodies are so ugly. They're so horrible. And I saw just how revolting bodies are, actually. I said, God, I hate bodies, looking at bodies. They're just, it is, the humanness, I just felt humanness is extremely revolting, actually. And it just made this very strong impression upon me. Oh my God. Just saw it, you know, for what it is. And then they had some actress come on, and I was just like, I cannot watch. It was so revolting to me. I just had to leave. And finally, I checked back a little bit, is Bumgarner, and yet finally he came on. I said, oh, okay. And watch that. It was this real short little thing, you know. That was it. I said, oh God, thank you. Whew, turn that off. Now, I haven't watched network television for, you know, super long time. Super long time. I just tuned it all out, you know. Tuned it all out. I paid no attention to actors and actresses and celebrities and network TV. Basically, all I watch on TV is the Giants baseball, maybe a little basketball, golf. I think that's pretty much it. And try to limit all that. Everything else, no, pay no attention to whatsoever. I don't read the gossip magazines. Don't look on internet. Forget it. So, in seeing this network television, it just blew my mind of how revolting it really is. Psychopathic revolting. Revulsion. So really, I felt like just this, it was hideous. 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 It really is hideous, as a matter of fact. It really is. Those of us who are working to awaken from this hideous dream, we're working to take this leap of faith into I don't know. I don't knowness. This wonderful I don't knowness, meaning all is totally indeterminate. To see this culture, it's hideous. Grotesque. These words are not even strong enough, but you get the picture. You get the picture. As I experienced, I was really shocked. Really shocked. I said, "Oh my gosh, what am I going to do in this world? This is just horrible." And and I came across today something else that this amazing stuff. This woman who was so masculine. And so aggressive, and so controlling, and so powerful, and everything. You could just feel, you know, you just, suddenly I just had this epiphany, and I just realized, you know, what's going on in this world, the way nature really is. And I think men occupy, actually, their status is lower than animals to women. It goes women, animals, dogs, animals, and then men, actually. This is true. And this is, it was unrepentant, it was obvious, you know, blatantly celebrating. I said, oh yeah, okay, you're the boss. And I said, wow, I don't want that. I don't want to live as, you know, some lowly creature, you know. I'm spirit. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me to be. All our spirit, we're all spirit, we're formless. We don't have any status. That's absolutely insane. So I'm just getting these epiphanies of the world, just how grotesque it is. Nature is completely grotesque. And when you see it, you wonder, how could I ever have thought it, seen it otherwise? Well, we don't really see it as otherwise. Not really. But we're under pressure to pretend otherwise. And of course, those who have a severe continuity fear, they don't want to wake up from the dream. They want to keep dreaming. So they say, hey, make my dream beautiful. You know, basically the women say to men, hey, make my dream beautiful. And work to make me comfortable and nice and everything. And some will trickle down to you and stuff. But you know, the dreamers who feel, you know, they want to keep dreaming, want to make sure that this dream seems lovely enough that they don't want to wake up. So you get enslaved to working on trying to make this dream look better instead of just waking up from the dream, right? So then you keep pretending like bodies are wonderful. Bodies are wonderful. I mean, this actress came on. I guess everybody thinks she's some like unbelievable diva goddess or something. And to me, it was like a giant slug, slimy slug coming on or something. It was hideous. Hideous, actually. I couldn't even look. Couldn't even look. Oh, this is just hideous. I mean, worshiping human form is hideous. You know, thinking it's beautiful is hideous. Absolutely hideous. And the more we try to make it more beautiful, the more hideous it becomes. So, it's always that way, actually. It's a nightmare. Nature is a nightmare. It is an absolute nightmare. So, we are working to take this leap of faith. This leap of faith that frees us from this. Now, what do we do when we're free? No deals. No deals. Absolutely no deals. I have no deals to make. There are no deals to make. Very important. From both, if you have a perspective, if you happen to be a attention identified as a female, or attention identified as a male, both say no deals, no deals, no deals, no deals, no deals to make, no deals to make. Very important, because this whole thing of keeping this thing going, nature is making all these deals. The men say, hey, can I get a deal from you? And the women say, you know what? I think I'm going to make you a deal so you can keep working for me. And see, the man says, yeah, I don't want to keep working. I don't really want to wake up. Can you make me a deal? But I feel like really lowly. Oh, okay, we'll make you a deal if you do this. Oh, okay, great. I'll mow your lawn, you know, keep everything looking great. Okay, yeah, it's a deal. And they say, okay, I'll pat you on the back. And you know, so there's always deals. There's always deals being made. Don't say no deals. No deals. Whatever your status in this nature thing, when you step free of nature, say, no deals, I'm not making any deals at all. No deals. No deals and no explanation. Okay, no deals, no explanation. This is the practice. This is not some sort of smart alecky remark. People misunderstood me when I came in the world. They thought I was some smart aleck. No, I was trying to say this is how you should be practicing. Okay. No deals, no explanation. This is I call it Christian Dzogchen, you know, really. I call myself a Christian Dzogchenist. because it's you know, the Nazarene Jesus Christ. And for instance, Longchenpa, the great Dzogchen master, they're talking about exactly the same thing. All right. They reinforce, it's all one truth. So, but I come from a culture, a Christian culture, and Jesus is my, you know, central a teacher, so to speak, conveys through this culture a way of understanding it. So Christian, but not the Christian the way that people think of Christian usually in this nature, Nate's understanding in the context of nature, which is not, never will be the right understanding. So I say, qualify, also Dzogchen, you know, but people don't quite know where to put that. So a Christian Dzogchenist. Christian Zogchenist. Or a Zogchen. I'm a Zogchen Christian. A Zogchen Christian. There you go. See, that's something for all of you. And I don't favor men over women or women over men. I'm just telling you, as it is, how to get free from nature. Because what everyone is, is spirit. None of us are bodies at all. None of us are bodies whatsoever. So we have to get free of that delusion that we're a body. So Jesus says, actually, he says, when you come to this, my teaching, come to it, always come to it, and use this practice when you come to it. I am not a body, I am free. I am spirit as God created me. I am still spirit as God created me. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. He says, that is the basic step. So if there was a liturgy, the first thing you would say is, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. I am still spirit as God created me. Or as I say, I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. Okay. This would be the beginning of the liturgy. And from the way I see the world, there's a necessity for a liturgy. I've not been able to bring one forth. The world doesn't seem to be interested in it. I've tried a lot, but you need some discipline. The one thing that I see in the world is lack of discipline. If you want to talk about failure, talk about lack of discipline. All right, lack of discipline. We all suffer from it. I suffer from it. We all want to feel like it shouldn't require any discipline on our part, but it does require some discipline. And we're all afraid to get into any sort of structure, liturgy, and stuff like that. You know, that's what I see. The world just rejects it now. Maybe because it's so effective. And the world thinks that it's fashioning some deal, you know, social deal, the new world order, some sort of social deal that's going to make the continuity problem vanish, you know, like that. Or make it vanish by saying, well, we don't have to, we get to keep it because we're happy here. Everything, all this inequality has been ironed out. No, it hasn't. Now, of course, they will, you know, the technology, science and technology claims they can iron it all out, but not really. Even if you make everything like test tubes and life in test tubes and, you know, stuff like that, then, you know, then this is the scientists, the ones that produced it. They're trying to find some sort of, you know, utopian way to bring about equal status in nature and stuff like that. But it's still the production of form. It's still the production of form that's essential. And still, throughout nature, there is this a fundamental importance of producing form, producing form, producing form. However you look at it, you can't escape it. The purpose of the dream cannot be escaped except by awakening from the dream. Or Jesus says, dream a dream within the dream. So people are so frightened of the leap of faith into indeterminate, I don't know, that they're willing to go into the fourth dimensional nonsense of trying to figure out some way to make it a little fairer and manipulate nature and try to change nature and all this stuff. Okay, it's a nightmare. It's a nightmare. And we don't have to do that. We don't have to go into that at all. We can say, no. It's easy. Just no deals. No deals. We make no deals with nature whatsoever. Supernature is the quote-unquote one deal. When they talk about Christianity, it says there's only one way. What it means is there's only one deal. It's the deal that God made called the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is it symbolizes, as it were, the miraculous supernature, the capacity that we have, the intermediate step we have of still having form, except there's no process really. It all feels indeterminate, even though the form is there. That's the only deal there is. That's the only deal that's necessary. It's the only deal that's necessary. It's a dream within the dream. An illusion that Jesus says, illusion that ends all illusions. So, Dzogchen Christian. Speaking from the standpoint of a Dzogchen Christian. Like that, right? Now, this is perfectly fine. I mean, looking at just bare bones Christianity, the way that it's played and playing out, you know, in spite of all of the positives, there were many positives, but there's also a lack of what I call escape velocity, actually, and a lot of magical belief and a lot of magical solutions and all that, which are still present. So the numbers of continuity fear is still very much in control of that. Now, when Jesus came, when he came first, this first time he came here, as far as giving out the gospel, he may have been here previous lives prior to being the Nazarene, and he said, look, you don't understand what I'm trying to tell you. You don't understand. You won't be able to understand. So I have to make it real simple for you. Parables and allegories. Why? Because you have severe continuity problem, severe sin, severe confusion problem, which they did. So he says, you know, you're going to need the Holy Spirit to explain it to you. And gradually, you'll get clearer and clearer about it. And they said, at some point, I'll be able to speak to you directly, actually. I'll be able to speak to you directly. And really, you know, just directly. Okay, so the second coming of Jesus, what might that be? Well, part of it might be when Jesus comes back and speaks to us directly about truth. Well, guess what? That's already happened. It's already happened. In A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words and the Other Voice, Jesus is speaking very directly indeed. And we are adjusting to that. You know, I've spent my whole life adjusting to this. It's just like, wow. So you really have to burn up the continuity fear. Now, another very important issue. Shift gears a little more here. Keep the video interesting. Keep your attention on this. You know, I know it's not easy for you to spend this time here, but we all appreciate it. This level confusion is something that I've spoken about in the past. And what continuity fear generates is what's called level confusion. And what level confusion, intuitively you know what I'm talking about. When you use words, it's easy to confound yourself, okay, and trip yourself up. Now, continuity fear uses level confusion to protect itself from truth, from awakening. And level confusion can become so dense and heavy that it seems like a massive solid block of like the carbon steel or titanium that you just no way can you ever get through it. And then what happens is you then interpret that as thinking this is natural, this is God given, that we're human, God doesn't want us to be divine, and there's this wall, solid wall separating the two, and never can the two ever meet, so to speak. And they say, oh, this is creation, this is God. No, it's level confusion. It's level confusion is what it is. Now, so yet it seems so difficult. You cannot directly argue and reason away level confusion directly. What you have to do is lessen the continuity fear. And as you lessen the continuity fear, you will automatically project less level confusion. So you just say, well, I don't need that much of it. And so you'll feel less and less level confusion. Like now, I don't get tripped up on it hardly at all. So it's like for me, instead of the solid wall, massive barrier, is now just like air. I can just like walk through it like there's nothing there at all. And of course, people look at that and say, how is that? It's impossible. You just walk through the solid wall. And so the problem is in this world, as you talk about stuff like I'm talking about, try to give the good news, and you just breeze through it. And they say, well, wait a minute, you just walked right through this continuity, this level confusion. And you just walked through that and that. You walked through this whole massive block of level confusion. That's not possible. Wait a minute, you know, this is a trick. You're deceiving me. You're a sorcerer. You know, what is this? See, for them, they see this as is impenetrable wall of whatsoever. No solidity to whatsoever anymore. Because the continuity fear doesn't need it. I don't need it to appear to trip me up and be a block there, you know. So this is a severe problem, and this needs to be recognized. So you cannot, that's why I say less spiritual dialogue, less explanation, more practice. Because as the more you practice, the more you evaporate this continuity fear, and the less need you have for level confusion. And God knows I've been trapped in level confusion and tried to solve it intellectually and directly for so long, and it just absolutely tormented me. Drove me to just the most severe stress and despair. Because it's all arbitrary. I mean, it's completely based on continuity fear. And so you think that there's something reasonable you can, you know, change and get it to, and no. Because it's just based on fear. It's arbitrary, willful confusion and a conflation and a plausibility there. You know, I call it the logic of plausibility. It's level confusion, a logical plausibility. And so what happens is people get stuck in this talking and talking and talking. Don't make any headway. Don't make any headway that way in terms of trying to resolve this level confusion. What you need is to experience this breezing through it, a breeze, as it were. So like when you feel this breeze, you say, wow. It's a miracle. How come I be feeling this breeze? It's like this divine breeze. This is a solid wall, impenetrable wall, and yet I'm feeling this breeze that is like a miracle. You know, shakes up the mind, doesn't it? Staggers the mind. Well, what it is simply that there's no continuity fear from whatever's transmitting this. So there's no level confusion at all there. Just a free breeze. So it's very important to read books that have this quality of just breezing through, and to listen to those who have this fresh quality just breezing through. They're not tripped up by any level confusion, not tripped up by it. This is what gives you this feeling like, wow, what am I missing here? What's going on? And so I'm saying it's that you're experiencing that there isn't any wall there actually at all. It's all imaginary. It's all desire to believe that there's some God-given contradiction that is impenetrable and meant to be there and prevent you from experiencing the divine. It's all totally our own desire and fear that we're trying to confuse ourselves. But the confusion is not intrinsic in the slightest bit. It's non-existent, actually. So this is why I don't like dialogue, spiritual dialogue, something like that. No, you have to find some source that is just a breeze. It's just breezing through, fresh breeze. And that staggers the mind, and then you say, wow. And you get used to that breeze. Then the continuity fear is evaporating. And gradually, the level of confusion won't be in you. Just see it and say, oh, that's stupid. I'm not gonna be tripped up on that. You're not tripped up on it anymore. Then you can see clearly. This is how that is. This is why the whole guru system throughout the world, Lydian, you know, basic, have access to this breeze, this transmission. It's a transmission like a breeze. So, for instance, A Course in Miracles is a breeze. Okay, it feels this breeze. It's a, wow. Journey Beyond Words is even more fresh and intense breeze. It just feels like there's no level confusion there at all. It's just coming straight on through. No turbulence. It's just a smooth, gentle, beautiful breeze. Okay. And so I try to convey that in these tapes as I just keep breezing through it. Just breezing through it. This is what's important, is to feel that quality of the breeze. And this is what staggers the mind. And this is good. And then I say, just full stop in the mind, like, wow, I've just been staggered. This is great. Because you've felt the breeze. When you feel the breeze, it staggers you. And you say, I got a feeling that there isn't any wall there at all, you know. Is this something's coming through, you know, is some way there's a freedom. Somehow I'm not trapped. I may not understand it, you know, I may not see it yet, but I'm feeling it, that I'm not trapped, that I'm free, that all is free, actually. I'm feeling it in some deep way. And that's, my mind is just like staggered by this, because I'm thinking that there's this massive barrier, you know, but like there can't be this, you know. And so this is the experience. So of course, throughout history, those on the path have been encouraged, go to the saints, the sages, this and this and that, you know, who have this, who just breathe, who breathes through it, truly breathes through it. And then you get that transmission. And this greatly accelerates your path. It greatly accelerates your path. Now, in the West here, we've had to do it mostly through books. Of course, the Holy Bible also has that quality to it when Jesus is talking. Mostly when Jesus is talking. Now, Paul is a different story. Okay, Paul is a whole different story. we were in church last Sunday, and one of the second reading was the epistle of Paul to talking about baptism, and he basically says, when we're baptized, we share in the death of Jesus. We actually die ourselves, and then we're buried, you know, and then we come out, we're resurrected, and then all our sins are washed away, and we're free, and we're saved, and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, Paul had all these beliefs, you know. He was probably a Pharisee. And he had all these archaic beliefs, you know, and he's a wonderful, wonderful guy, wonderful spirit, Paul. But you really, sometimes I really wonder. There's Pauline Christianity, and then there's the Nazarene Christianity of Jesus, you see. And I don't think the two are the same, okay? I do not think the two are the same. Certainly. When Jesus has come back now with the Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, and the other voice, it certainly doesn't sound like Pauline Christianity at all. Not at all. So in my opinion, Paul was trying to sell this to the Romans because he wanted it to spread throughout the empire. He wanted to be the world religion, and then Rome was the world empire at that time. And he wanted to appeal to the Jews, still appeal to the Jews, because this was founded in among the Jews, the Christianity, okay? Wanted to appeal to the Jews, but wanted to be acceptable to the Gentiles. And so he was kind of like, you know, interesting character, how this whole thing went about. But listening to Jesus now, getting direct teaching, it doesn't sound like Pauline Christianity at all. And of course, this bothers a lot of Christians who are largely accepting Pauline Christianity. And they think that Jesus is supposed to agree with Paul, you know. Now, wait a minute. Wasn't Paul like the chief persecutor of Christians? Pharisaical persecutor of putting Christians to death, actually? Before he suddenly saw the light, you know, said, hey, wait a minute. Maybe I can market this religion or something. I don't know. But I mean, why does Jesus have to agree with Paul, right? So if you have two teachings, and one's Jesus and one's Paul, and they're different, who are you going to say, I'm going to go with who? You know, I'm going to go with Jesus' teachings for sure. And not saying there's some teachings of Paul that I like. You know, he had a lot of really very good qualities, actually. But we're talking about getting it straight from the mouth, from the source, straight from the source. Let's get it straight from the source here, and let's not mix oil and water, really. And Pauline Christianity has got a lot of very odd stuff that actually, one moment. And a lot of archaicness about it, going back to Zoroastrianism, Manichaeanism, and a lot of archaic teachings, actually. It actually has a lot in common with what I call dualistic teachings, very dualistic teachings. Jesus' teachings are absolutely non-dual. absolutely non-dual. So this is the breeze that you get, this absolute non-dual breeze. This is what I say you need to subject yourself to. And I say subject, meaning having the, it stuns the mind, it staggers the mind. When you hear this true non-dual teaching, you say, wow, I don't think I'm in Pauline Christianity anymore, right? This is, wow, what is this? Because Pauline Christianity basically is saying, yeah, there's this huge block there between the divine and human, but somehow, you know, there's a way to bridge it, or, you know, magically do something, or get some, you know, they don't ever get to realize there is no block there. They're saying there is a block, but, whereas non-duality says there's no block at all. It's only expression of a continuity fear, temporary expression of a continuity fear, which is level confusion, okay? Whereas the dualistic teachings say that God is, this is a block that God has put in there, or sin has put there, and there has to be some, you know, some force or something applied to it, or, you know, right? Some magical sacrifice, something. That's dualism. Okay. It's to say, this is real, but there's a way to deal with it. Whereas non-duality says, no. There is no block there whatsoever. It's a mirage. It's an illusion. It's just a logical plausibility. It's actually not even there at all. God never placed any barrier. There is no barrier in reality. We are not bodies. In fact, there's no such thing as bodies or worlds or anything actually determinate. There's nothing determinate whatsoever. Never has been. As Longchenpa says, an unreleased event is impossible. An unreleased event is impossible. And of course, there's no residue whatsoever, ever. So there's never been any determinacy. So what dualism says, there's been determinacy, but there's some way to adjust ourselves in some way to this, or somehow to be freed of the determinacy, or something, so, you know. It causes all sorts of confusion, actually, dualism. All sorts of confusion. A swamp of confusion. When you realize there's never been any determinacy whatsoever, the whole thing is resolves, you know. It's simple. Wow. So being a Dzogchen Christian is a way of saying that you're not a Pauline Christian, so to speak. But without hating on Pauline Christianity at all, like I said, there's a lot of really very, very good aspects to it and helpful aspects to it. But it's contorted. It's kind of like trying to fit a round peg into a square hole, a square peg into a round hole, or something. You know, it's convoluted. It's overly convoluted, and that excessive convolution, then people just kind of like stagnate, which is what you get in the churches. Everybody's telling me, and I'm seeing. I'm very observant about the whole religious scene, and people say, "Wow, it's so stagnant. It's so stagnant. It's just godliness has dropped away from people." You know, it's all just entertainment now. It's all entertainment and prosperity talk, you know. Bread and circuses, prosperity entertainment talk. Or entertainment and prosperity talk, every way, which way you want to look at it. So that's what happens with duality. Duality, you know, it's a swamp. People just finally say, wow, okay. Just give me. I mean, this Jimmy Fallon character is apparently he's a Catholic. You know, is this, are you kidding me? Oh my gosh! He should not be Catholic and acting like that. You know, you have some dignity. Speaking of dignity, do we not all have the right to life, truly life, true life? Do we not all have the right to be super smart? This what this world is, the pagan, what I call the heathen pagan world, is a world of smart. Okay. Everybody wants, the goal is to be smart. But what it really does is it outlaws being super smart. Okay. So we're really, truly super smart. I came in the world, I was super smart because I was in touch with spirit, a feeling of spirit. And you know, many of us come in the world as super smart and we gradually lose it. For me, I didn't lose it so quickly. I had a real big battle over this. And what I found out is the world is the most intolerant place imaginable. It's completely intolerant to being super smart. It only says you can only be smart. You can't be super smart. So you have this cult. The world's really a cult of smartness that disallows any super smartness. And so, of course, they have a religion and various, but they always say that no religion can only be a smart religion. A smart religion. A smart phone, so to speak. A smart phoniness. But no super smartness here is allowed. It's disallowed entirely. This world is totally intolerant. This world loves to trumpet how tolerant they are, especially those who wear their tolerance on their sleeve. But if you scratch them, you know, you'll find out they're super intolerant towards super smartness. Entirely so. Entirely intolerant of it. So who wants to live in this cult of intolerance, actually? Don't we have a right to super smartness? Absolutely we do. Absolutely we do. We all intrinsically have a right to super smartness. So this is a cause celeb, you know, that I certainly have been fighting for my whole life, not gaining any traction, because the intolerance here is overwhelming. Absolutely overwhelming. But this pure non-dual is super smart. You know, when I hear pure non-dualist talk, it's like, ah, this wonderful breeze. Thank you, thank you. Like I just heard Punjaji, Papaji from Lucknow. When I hear him talk, sometimes it's like, I come across a video, and it's just like, oh, I feel like there's like a fresh breeze, just like, oh, just straight through. There's no level of confusion, you know. You just feel this, oh, that's so nice. That is so lovely. So beautiful. Thank you, thank you, thank you. As an example, is he? And there are other pure non-dualists, like Ramana Maharshi's and another one, for sale. It all depends. Sometimes you'll get this feeling from one, and then sometimes from another, like that. Depending on how, you know, the intolerance of the culture keeps shifting, trying to, you know, knock it out of you entirely. And say, no, you just got to be really good at being smart. And like the Silicon Valley is the home for smartness, is the, you know, ground zero for smartness. Everybody's here is smart, really smart. But there's nobody here hardly super smart at all. No, that doesn't exist here. It doesn't even exist. But they all are smart. It's a culture of smartness here, an intense culture of smartness. That's why I feel like a fish out of water here. It's like, God, I feel so dumb here, you know. It's so dumb to be in a culture of smartness. It is so dumb. It's incredibly dumb. When you're super smart, you're in touch with super smartness, which is truth, really. Non-dual, pure non-dual truth within you. When you're in touch with that, then the smartness is like super dumb, super duper dumb. So I feel like I'm around all these super dumb people, and it's such a drag. It is such a drag, really. Especially because they're all pretending to be smart. They don't need to listen to anyone else. They feel that they're inherently the smartness. They went to college. They got a degree. They got a nice job. What do they need to listen to anyone for? They're smart. Everyone thinks they're smart. Well, they are smart, but they're incredibly dumb because they're disallowing super smartness within them. So, you know, what you need is people who are humble enough to say, you know what? I don't think being smart is where it's at. I don't think being smart is where it's at. Sometimes the people who feel like there's got some super smartness going on, they never even went to college, were not interested in school, because they said, this is just dumbness. And I was like that. I said, hated school. I think very early on in school, I think it was by the seventh grade, I quit completely as far as paying any attention. I said, all they're doing is dumbing me down. That's all they're doing. They're teaching smartness, whereas I am super smart. I am super smart. I am this is super smart. Super smart. Okay. That's a way of just delineating it from smartness. So oftentimes those who are super smart forget schooling, you know. And some of those who come in as super smart maintain it, never even go to school or pay no attention. Sri Sri and I to my mom, I just paid no attention to schooling whatsoever. Went to school for a couple years or something, and she said that automatically some power just took care of it. Of course they know that I'm not here to be dumbed down. I'm here to be the breeze of super smartness. The breeze of super smartness. So we get it sometimes in books, sometimes. And I'm trying to expand that into some sort of transmission here of what live hearing, you know, speaking sort of thing like this, yeah. And we bring it full circle back to the status thing. Remember, no deals, no deals. I don't need to make any deals. This goes for both the female and male listeners. I don't need to make any deals, no deals. Reality doesn't require any deals. Super smartness doesn't require any deals whatsoever. You're not a body. You're free. You don't need to make any deals with nature at all. Except the one God has made of super nature. That can be an intermediate step for us. So we don't feel like we're plunged into pure formlessness forever, immediately, right? It's kind of like a water slide. You know, there's this beautiful pool way down there, and you're way up on top of this mountain. How do I get down that pool? Oh, there's a nice water slide. Just get the water slide and just phew, all the way down. And finally, by the time you get down close to the pool, you feel like, oh yeah, this, I feel really comfortable here. And then you go into the pool, right? Like that, the pool of formlessness. So we have this beautiful water slide. We have to get on it. We have to just leap of faith. Just leap of faith into it. I don't know. I don't know. There's nothing to know. I do not know. I'm spirit. All is indeterminate. Again, what does indeterminate mean? It means that every moment is free and clear of every other moment. We're perfectly free to choose a different experiencing every instant. Okay. No instant binds us in any way to the next instant in terms of choice. In no way is God preferring any experience over another and saying, oh, yeah, I want you to keep experiencing this experience, or, oh, I want you to change that you're experiencing. This next moment, you need to change it. No, there's no determinacy whatsoever in reality. So we're entirely free, indeterminate. No specificity as to what we need or have to experience. Whatever it is that gives us joy, whatever it is that we're interested in, whatever it is we want to play with, whatever it is, whatever we want to be experiencing, whatever we want, this spiritual feeling of a total immersion, so to speak, then that's what we're free. We're free to experience that. We're always free. We're free right now. Everyone's all free this moment. Everyone's always been free. Even though we choose to use our freedom to try and imprison ourselves into a sequencing that seems as though we're not free. A choosing, a concatenation of mental, you know, desiring that tends to think that we're in chains, you know. Well, we're not in chains at all. But certainly the illusion is very powerful. So I just got called to dinner. Did I go in? No. See, I'm free. I'm not a slave. But practical purposes in this world, you know, you better not be too uppity, especially men. Absolutely. They're going to catch hell for sure if you got to be a good little slave here. But the door is open. We're trying to open this door, and we're trying to get the context here, spiritual practice for everyone. In this breeze, okay, let's go back to this breeze. Very important. Just experience the breeze. Don't explain it. Don't try to put it in words. Don't try to label it. Because don't try to figure out, well, how did it get through all these barriers? There's no barriers. So what you should be feeling is like, wow, maybe there's no barriers. Maybe there's nothing to explain. Maybe there's nothing to explain. Maybe there's no deal that needs to be made. Maybe there's no deal that needs to be made at all. See, look at it that way. There's no smarts like that that need to be used. You see, being super smart is to realize there's no barrier at all. Whereas be smart is saying, wow, there's an incredibly intense barrier, huge wall, and maybe I can climb up that wall or something. As this dualism, the Gnostic, Manichaean, Zoroastrian, Abrahamic religions to a large extent, dualistic, you know, most teachings are dualistic, actually. The philosophies are dualistic, most of them. That they're saying, yeah, we're in this terrible pit, but we can at least climb up, make some progress climbing. May not be able to get out of the pit, but then God will reach down and make us happy as we're in the higher levels of the pit or something. Yeah, we're these bodies, we're humans, this world, all this is real, but we can somehow, at least God will stop being angry at us. You know, God will stop punishing us, you know. We'll be reconciled to God, and God made this creature, you know, we're a creature, but and God's angry at us because we're not being a good creature, but somehow we get something that stop God's anger at us, and then God will say, okay, you're a good creature, and then we'll say, oh, thank you, God, I can be happy now because I'm a good creature, you know. All of this stuff, you know, this is not the breeze, is it? It doesn't feel like this cool fresh breeze, this fresh breeze, and it doesn't feel like it at all. It feels like stagnant fetid air. Like you're in some kind of cesspool, and you're trying to get some air that doesn't smell as terrible. You're like, maybe this is a little better. I don't know. I thought I caught maybe some. Well, this isn't so terrible. Maybe just come on over here, and I said maybe over here maybe the air's a little better over here. You're like that, and then you get this fresh breeze of non-dualism. It's like, wow, what is that? It's shocking. Stunning, staggering. So again, the practice is to be staggered, which I say, sit quietly, sit still, don't get up, don't move, don't even think about it. Or as they say, you can think about it, but don't do it. And if you're not going to do it, don't even think about it. So your mind can be staggered by this fresh breeze. You're just saying, holy cow, where did that fresh breeze come from? I'm in this deep, 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 dark pit, a cesspool of this horrible stagnant air. How in the world could this completely fresh air just come through here? It's not possible. And yet, there it was. I thought, I must be dreaming this. Must be dreaming. Of course, the truth is, the dream is that we're in this deep, dark pit, the cesspool. That's the dream. We're not there at all. We're on perfect solid ground, as it were. There's no pit at all. So what we're doing is we're starting to wake up and say, hey, wait a minute, that terrible air was just a dream. There's no terrible air at all. It's perfect. The air is completely perfect. And therefore nothing needs to be explained, right? Except I just woke up. Yeah, I was just dreaming. We don't have to explain how the dream is producing this fresh air. It's not the dream that's producing it. This isn't inherently. This is the very nature of reality. Again, reality is inherently great. Okay. Whether anything is manifest or unmanifest, the very nature of reality, the very is, the isness, is inherently great. All potential is always there, and the wish-fulfilling nature of reality is always there, always present. So the complete presence is there. Doesn't matter what you're choosing to experience. The great it's inherent greatness. And as Jesus says, as you relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go, you don't fall into a vacuum. As you make this leap of faith and say, I do not know, you don't fall into any vacuum. You become aware of the inherent greatness of reality. Completely awesome greatness of it all. Totally supportive. Infinitely supportive and inclusive. Without any status or prejudice or levels at all. Infinitely fair. Perfectly just. inescapably just, as far as everyone is completely innocent. All is totally innocent. No accountability, all is perfectly innocent. All is perfectly innocent. Without any possibility it could be any otherwise. One family, one spiritual family. One perfect spiritual family. And that's us, that's us, that's everything. So to have the mind staggered, one should sit quietly, don't get up. I think if you get up, you're gonna die. Yeah, that's one technique. If I get up, I'm gonna die. I don't dare get up. I've got to keep work through and get the mind staggered and get used to it, because this is what's called moving one's comfort zone. It's called awakening. You gradually say, hey, I'm getting used to this unimpeded breeze. Maybe this is just the way that it is. And as we move towards allowing that continuously, no explanation, no deals. Don't need to make any deals. Don't need to give any explanation. Don't need to make any labels. No labels, no exclusions, no exemptions, no exceptions. No exemptions, no exceptions. Pure, unequivocal, no exceptions, no exemptions, no explanation, no labeling. No figuring out, no deals to be made. So, cool down. Don't come out of this abruptly. It's not good to come out abruptly, because then you'll think you were just dreaming. You know, you'll write it down to, oh, this was just all a dream. So it's important to just have a cool out period. I just sort of mentally felt I need to go eat dinner, and then I sort of felt so abrupt. I said, wow, it turns it into like it was just like some separate, disjointed, dreamlike experience here instead of this intense spiritual practice. So most definitely there needs to be a cool-out period. But just why is it very important to give it a length of time? Very important. Otherwise, it may start fostering the wrong sort of conclusions. Get in trouble with that, so. So I do not know, I do not know, I do not know. Yes, 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 I do not know. I do not know. I am. I do not know. I am. I do not know, I am. I do not know, I am. I am, I am, I am, I am, I am. As Jesus said, there's only isness. Which cannot be captured in concepts. So the breeze, the breeze, the breeze, the breeze, the breeze. Keep getting in front of the fan somehow. Feel that breeze. Fresh, unimpeded breeze. Non-dual breeze, just breezing through. So I'm trying my best, and I'm sure I'll get better, better and better at it. But in the meantime, I have to deal with the backlash from this because the world is so incredibly intolerant of super smartness. They're trying to pull everything down into just smartness. This world right now is trying to pull everything. This world is insanely iconoclastic, actually. We hear about iconoclasts destroying statues and, you know, going crazy, and like the what was it, the Coptic Christians, or the, anyway, in Alexandria, burning Alexandria down, burning the library, just becoming super iconoclastic towards the pagans there. They reached a boiling point, and they just became incredibly iconoclastic. And then other examples throughout history of wanting to just, you know, tear down everything that they don't agree with. Well, the world right now, the globe, wants to tear down all that is super smart. So you might say we have this incredibly barbaric, iconoclastic movement in the world taking place. You know, we criticize, for example, the world criticizes the radicals who are doing things and have done things. You might say the Chinese in Tibet are very iconoclastic, right? Destroying so many monasteries and just tearing down everything that has to do with religion. That's an example of extreme iconoclastic. And then the Taliban, for instance, can be very intolerant and very iconoclastic. But the fact is that the whole globe right now is insanely iconoclastic, insanely intolerant, tearing down everything that is super smart, as if they don't want it to ever exist. It's like burning the Library of Alexandria, which had all the knowledge of the ancient world. I mean, there's so much history, there's so much in there, almost all of it was lost. The world's gone through repetitive cycles of iconoclastic activity. Not all of it good, you know, not all of it entirely bad, but certainly much of it not so wise. And right now in this world, we're going through the worst ever. Jesus said it'll be the worst time ever in this world, from a spiritual standpoint of tearing down all that is super smart, all that is truly this, the breeze of pure non-dualism. There's this massive effort to pull it down into smartness, So you've got these forms and labels and stuff. Say, oh yeah, this is Zoc Jain, or this is Christian, or this is. But it's now been put into a context of smartness. You see, smartness taught in the university, you know, classes. How to take it to class? Oh yeah, I can take a class in Zoc Jain. This is pulling it down into smartness. See, the super smart don't look at it that way at all. That's not, this stuff is not an end in itself. It's a means to an end. And has to be practiced, and the mind has to be staggered, and you have to have the discipline, and you have to have the perseverance, and push it, keep working on it, and it's an epic ordeal. It's intense. So, this is what we're doing here, but the world is getting to me, you see, is collapsing it all into smartness. Massive collapse. Massive iconoclastic collapse right now. So, like a constriction hitting my throat. It's hitting again. That shows you how difficult it is to speak like this. Actually, when I was young, around 12, when I stopped being able to speak, I got severe bronchitis, and all I could do was cough all the time for years and years. That was the repression, that was the intolerance of the world. pressuring me into being incapable of talking and expressing non-duality. So literally, it literally affected my breathing and my speaking. So if I started to talk, I would start coughing and I couldn't stop coughing. This came from the intolerance of the world, that kind of classic intolerance of this world. Area, the breathing area is like being like this. Intensely. What a reaction. So that can happen. Wow. It's almost like a bronchial attack. It's an irritation that it demands a cough, you know, demands a reaction so I can't breathe properly or talk properly. So this is intense transmission here. This is intense. This is bringing about a severe reaction. I almost died many, many times from simply couldn't stop coughing. So much congestion. I could, a lot of times I couldn't breathe. It was horrible. I didn't tell anybody because I knew that this is what everybody actually wanted. And they would, you know, say, oh, okay, well, let's take some drugs or something. See, it's very difficult for anyone to speak like this. There's a constriction that the body, the mind is constricting that shows up in the body. And makes it very difficult for anyone to speak and transmit this breeze. And it may make it very difficult for anyone to listen too. You may get all sorts of itches and scratches and reactions, you know. Your mind is like, wow, I can't listen to this. I've got to distract myself. Really shook things up. It just happened like out of the blue, just like that. Suddenly. It's like my throat was blocked. These blocks are level confusion. Thinking that they think they're blocks, it's just level confusion. See, in explaining all of this, this released a tremendous block. The belief in the block. So my whole system is just reverberating now. Wow. Severely shaken up. There's all sorts of kind of reverberations, like an earthquake, aftershocks going on. Is it possible that there are quote-unquote places that one can go, sacred places. Well, looking at it, actually, since there aren't any places, no time, space, process, or form whatsoever, everything is just an expression of our continuity fear, is all indeterminate. It is absolutely possible that there can be places where mentally, the mental projection may not be so extreme. There may have been some very sacred, holy transmissions there, and that area still is, seems as though mentally there's not as much blockage there, you see. Even though there's no blockage anywhere, actually, it may, from the standpoint of the dream, may seem that there's some places may seem sacred. Maybe you can go there and you can be staggered. That's possible. Where the acceptance in the mind that this place, or this, in the dream, that this place doesn't have as much continuity fear and of less level confusion. This may be somehow accepted in the mind. So there may be then places where we're going to go to. But of course, also keep in mind that if this is the case, then also you can also avoid those places and think that you're avoiding it, you see. So it's a little tricky, actually. It's dualistic, it's somewhat dualistic. But if you see it in the right way, it is theoretically, I would say, it is possible. But really, there's no level confusion, blockage anywhere. There's no blockage anywhere. It's not like some places are less determinate than others. There's no determinism anywhere. But in terms of the dream, the dream could seem that way mentally to us. Like Ramana saying, the spiritual heart is on the right side. And then he told Punjaji, no, it's actually everywhere. There's no location at all. But for those who believe the dream is real, it makes some sense to say, well, it's somewhere. You can, you know, some positive focus or something. Well, I sure got my bell rung there very strongly. That's great. That's great. That is an ordeal. This is wonderful. Okay. So, as we know, this severe iconoclastic dumbing down is happening in the world into smartness, being trumpeted as some great advance. We know the pressure's on us severely. Those who want to be super smart are under enormous duress right now. So, we pray to Jesus, we pray to whoever we want to pray to. We pray to the clear light. We pray to the transmission, the breeze, the divine breeze. We pray to grace of God, the Holy Spirit. We pray to whoever we want to pray to, that all help be given to us right now. Okay, very great. That's it.